A quick note before we get started. This episode contains reference to suicide and suicidal ideation. All right. We're officially on the hunt.
So today is a big day. We are, I think, as close as ever to maybe solving this thing.
Our journey to solve the mystery of the chlorine gas attack at Midwest Fur Fest has brought us to East Oklahoma, a few miles from the Arkansas border. It's less flat plains here than I'd imagined. If anything, the rolling woodland reminds me a bit of the English countryside. When we arrived at the Airbnb last night, cows in the next door field stared us down mournfully all the way to the door. I don't know. It's not just me. Max, our producer, is feeling it too. We're a bit jumpy.
God, this is a weird one.
It's a fucking weird one, isn't it?
You just had to pick the weird one.
I know. Could have done, I don't know, something.
Couldn't just a nice murder in a small town, yeah, like every other podcast. You had to do...
Up until a few weeks ago, there had only been one major suspect on the board. Robert Sitchkowski. Now, there are two.
Yeah, so we are in Westville, Oklahoma.
90 minutes outside of Tulsa.
Yeah, 90 minutes outside of Tulsa. We've got all of our equipment. We're ready to roll. It's pretty nerve-wracking to be here, especially because Caleb kind of came out of a clear blue sky to start with, right? He was the FBI's lead suspect, which we had no idea about until we got hold of those documents.
Here's what we know about the guy originally referred to only as the Oklahoma suspect. The guy we tracked down using Facebook and Google Street View and public record searches. The guy we're now, in theory, about to meet. Caleb Kincaid. We know the FBI was alerted to him by a tip-off. We know two agents met him at his residence on December 9th, just 2 days after the attack. We know he told them that the furry fandom saved his life, that he'd been to 23 conventions, but Midwest Fur Fest wasn't one of them, because he prefers outdoor conventions to indoor. We know he told them he was the primary caregiver for his disabled father and had been home with him the weekend of the gas attack, that he told them he'd gone to visit his nephew nearby in Westville on the Saturday and gone to Walmart on the Sunday. We also know the FBI then came back and interviewed him again in 2019. We think because the statute of limitations was about to run out and they wanted to make one last effort to get something over the line. Kincaid's been blowing a bit hot and cold in communications with us. Our last couple of messages have been left on read, and he hasn't picked up our last few phone calls. My phone's sitting out on the table while Max and I decide to record ourselves doing a bit of prep.
But yeah, let's go through our transcript of the conversation with Caleb and figure out if that made us think that the FBI was wrong to have had him as suspect number one.
Well, also even finding this guy.
And somehow, that's exactly when he calls me back.
What? That's him. Hey, man, Caleb.
Hey, sorry about that. I'm out here working. They got me hauling concrete off today. It'll be this evening. We'll be able to meet up, do something.
Yeah, perfect. That works for us. What time?
I don't know. It's whatever. Probably send me out about 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock, so call it 7?
Yeah.
Perfect. Should we come to you?
Yeah, we'll figure out something from there. I'll give you the address of the house.
Okay, cool. We'll see you a bit later on.
Alright. Sweet. That worked. Talk to you after a while.
Alright, talk to you in a bit.
Alright, bye.
Let's fucking go.
Sick. Alright, timing couldn't have been better either.
Alright. Well, I guess we've got ourselves a ball game. From Brazen, this is Fur and Loathing. I'm Nikki Wolf. Episode 4. The Furry with the Gas.
Yo, it's Nikki here.
Yeah, So we went, we got to Gas MX and then went up. We're now outside Solid Rock Church.
You went too far. Come back down the hill.
Where's the right road, right?
Yeah, that's the right road.
That's a relief.
So yeah, come back down the hill. I'm standing out here, walking out by the road.
Okay, sweet. All right, we should see you any second.
Oh yeah, I'm wearing bright red coveralls. You can't miss me.
Nice. We got a camera set up in the back. You can't miss us either.
We pull into a dirt driveway and round to the front of a tumble-down double-wide trailer. It's set back a bit from the road, surrounded by trees. There's junk strewn all around and a rust-stained red pickup truck with huge vertical exhaust behind the cab. It looks like something out of Mad Max. Caleb greets us in bright red overalls.
Just please ignore the construction debris pile. I haven't had a chance to get it. I work 7 days a week. So I haven't had a chance to get a trailer.
It's too messy inside to come in, he says, so we get set up on the porch in the fading light. He's in a folding chair, I'm perched on a cooler box.
Ouch. Only utility we have, I'm sorry, I only got one chair. The only utility...
Is that something I can sit on, or...?
Yeah, we'll move that. The only utility we have right now is electric. So no water, no gas, no. We've been here since the 1st of December.
Oh, dang, winter must have been intense.
Caleb is balding with piercing green eyes and a straggly chin strap beard. He's also got a really unhealthy sounding cough, which doesn't stop him from chain smoking throughout the interview.
Good morning, good evening, wherever you may be. Welcome to the Diamond K Cat Ranch, Watts, Oklahoma. We are live, people.
The first thing to say about Caleb Kincaid is the man has a sense of drama.
So I wonder if you could start by just sort of introducing yourself in that kind of classic podcast radio way.
My name is Cal in the real world. In the fandom, I am known as Jaeger Joachim Adolphus Stein, a.k.a. the giant troll with gas.
Me and Max give each other a meaningful glance. He just said gas, straight out. But it turns out he doesn't mean it exactly in the way we mean it.
Why do they call you the furry with gas?
Because I used to have several trophies for national and state and intercontinental farting championships. And the only reason I lost, I got fourth place in the global tournament in London, England, because of shit. You shit, you lose. I shit, I lost.
I don't know where any of us were expecting that to go, but it certainly wasn't here.
And of course, everybody knows me for blowing ass at conventions, because might as well share, I've already got it.
Mm. So it's like a different kind of gas.
Yeah, it's just ass gas. No, it's not a chemical weapon. It's a naturally occurring deposit of hydrogen sulfide and methane.
We'll circle back to the gas we're actually here to talk about. But first, who is this guy? Who is Caleb Kincaid?
Well, do you want to go by Jaeger in this, or do you want to go by Caleb?
Just call me Cal.
Cal?
That's what the bulk people know the difference. I mean, they all know. They'll look at me and go, I know that dork.
Cal says his father, grandfather, and even great-grandfather drove trucks. And among other odd jobs, so does he. Right now, he's got a gig hauling earth between construction sites in a gigantic dump truck.
In the Oklahoma world, I am just your average truck driver and construction worker and farmhand. And socially awkward, dee-dee-dee. About all I got really to describe that is just keep my head down, try to stay away from idiots, stay out of trouble, and try not to run over morons that are completely oblivious to the 31-ton truck right there by him.
He's quite a bit different to a lot of the furries we've met. Different background, different life.
And how, long have you
being in the furry fandom, like, how did you find your fursona?
I stumbled into it in 2004.
There is one part, though, that echoes something we've heard before, that for Cal, finding the furry community helped him out of a pretty dark place.
Going through a lot of just bad shit, bad depression, and I was actually thinking about blowing my brains out. And the funny part is on that, I tried 6 times with a revolver. All 6 shots failed to fire.
Wow.
Yeah. So I was supposed to be alive for a reason. Six out of six failure, that don't happen. But it's more of anymore I go just to see what kind of goofiness I'm going to see. Because I laugh at some of the dumbest shit. And I've met a lot of interesting people. Pardon me. I'm dying.
I'm trying to figure out exactly where Cal sees himself fitting within the furry constellation.
I break every stereotype. I'm conservative. I vote Republican. I'm straight. I'm blue-collar working class.
I mean, that's certainly true, but as we talk, some of the details Cal gives about his life are getting more and more eye-popping.
My great-aunt grew up in Birch's Gardens, and her family were the cleaning staff for the Berghof, for Hitler's private residence.
His great-great-great-great-uncle was a messenger, Bull Run and Gettysburg.
And then my great-great-great-great-grandpa was an artilleryman.
At various times, he talks about having ancestors fighting in the Civil War, Vietnam, Korea, World War I, World War II. The way he tells it, you could almost pick any historical battlefield, and you'd probably find one of his ancestors there. Possibly even several.
I had family on both sides of the conflict as well. One great uncle was Wehrmacht Army. We had one in the Navy. We had one in the Air Force. Yeah, I've done both because my grandpa went ashore, 32 years old, Omaha Beach. He was in the first wave, and he went all the way to Berlin.
Actually, you know how in the movie, Forrest Gump appears in the background of all those major historical events? It's starting to feel a little bit like that. He claims he served in the military himself, too.
You served in the military, right?
Yes.
Remind me when and what? It was Afghanistan?
We try not to talk about that because that's all sealed stuff. And let's just put it, that's Black Ops, and we don't bring that up usually. I can say yes. Combat service, U.S. Army, and that's about the extent that I'm allowed to actually go into detail past that.
All right. I feel bad about saying it, but this is where we can no longer avoid addressing this issue head on. Are we buying what Caleb is selling? Do we think his great aunt was Hitler's chambermaid? Do we think he was Army Black Ops in Afghanistan? If he was, the FBI didn't know about it. In fact, they specify in one of the documents that he has no military record. And much as it saddens me to have to inform you of this, while farting competitions are a thing, yeah, really, we could find no record of an international championship ever taking place in London. It's not that I think he's setting out to paint a false picture, and there could be a grain of truth in some of these things, but I think it's more that he gets caught up in the narrative flow. He wants to tell the best story, and sometimes that means massaging things a bit, adding embellishments here and there. If you're thinking dwelling on his exaggeration tick feels a bit mean-spirited, I get where you're coming from. Don't get me wrong, I think we all do this to one degree or another. I don't think hyperbole is malicious in and of itself, or evidence of a crime. If anything, I'm finding myself rather charmed by the larger-than-life picture Cal paints. But still, I'm finding it's good to listen to what he says with a pinch of salt near at hand, if you haven't grabbed for some already. And he's one of those talkers who, once they get up ahead of steam, there's no stopping him, and no telling where he's going to go next. We've been there several hours, though I haven't really noticed the time passing. I dragged the conversation along to how he created his fursona, Jägerstein.
But I always figured it'd be a wolf, because I was told by an old Indian lady years when I was a kid, she said, your spirit animal is a black wolf. So I just went with it. And I'm like, okay, I can build off this. And I've always had a bend for history and mythology. So I based it on a Anakimi, which is Sumerian mythology's elder gods that came before the Anunnaki. And they were shapeshifters. So that's where it come from. He'd shapeshift into a gigantic, about 7 foot tall, beat to hell, missing chunks, blind one eye, wolf.
The shapeshifter thing is interesting, because I can see how Cal might feel like that. He's stuck between two worlds. A working class life where most people, if they've heard of them at all, think furries are some kind of crazy internet deviants. And a furry community that doesn't always accept him either. In fact, he talked about that in our first phone call.
Do people, you know, respond when they find out you're a furry? Like, is that like occasionally, do people find that weird?
Yeah. I look like a stereotypical redneck. Mm-hmm. I've got a beard. Over the years, after working in the oil fields, I took to wearing coveralls, just simple, easy, and comfortable. But I've had furs come up to me and go, well, you're not a furry. You don't belong here. And my answer is, yeah, F you, go away.
Wow.
And then usually some...
As we've said before, the fandom contains multitudes.
I was going to say, we got nerds, we got geeks, we got dorks, we got losers, we got weirdos, we got perverts. We got people that work for NASA. We got people that work for JPL. We've got physicists, chemists, bioengineers, judges, lawyers, doctors, and then this goofy-ass son of a bitch right here.
And then the Nazis.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, yeah, them, but we just try to ignore them goofballs.
This is a tricky subject. The neo-Nazi and Confederate furries we've heard about. People like the furry raiders. When we were looking for Cal, the details we were coming up with meant that's the category he seemed to fit best into. He does World War reenactment, he's a fan of Confederate flags, that sort of thing.
Does that mean people lump you in with the Nazi fest because you're a conservative?
Some of them try to. And one of my things was I used to talk to the different groups to see what their deal was, because I was always curious. And it was like the Nazi furs that I asked him, I sat down and asked him, I said, so what is your deal here? You know, what do you think makes you fit into this group? Because I'm always curious why somebody does this. I mean, just because I'm curious. And because of that, I've been lumped in with a lot of groups.
But the furry raiders themselves, in this interview at least, Caleb is contemptuous.
There's drama around everything, but the more specific is the Nazi fur group, the Raiders. And these are just scumbags, straight up. And I told them to F off. I told them, just get away from me, F off, and go ruin someone else's day, not mine.
When did you encounter?
I encountered them at a large furry meet in Tulsa. And there was a bunch of them that showed up. And I flat out told him, I said, look, the reason nobody likes you, you guys are fucking dickheads. So go be dickheads somewhere else, leave us the hell alone, and stop starting shit. That you want to do something, go irritate. There's plenty of other groups you can go irritate.
So Caleb is saying what little interaction he's had with that group is to tell them to buzz off. It's easy to distance yourself after the fact, I guess, and we've got no way of corroborating this. But it's also worth mentioning that none of the data we've been compiling links him directly to the furry raiders either. It's time to bring the conversation round to when the authorities knocked at his door.
Torgus, tell us about when the FBI turned up. What's that like?
Scared the hell out of me. I was trying to get me to say I did, and I'm like, dude, I'm not admitting to something I didn't do. Fuck off.
Still though, I need to ask him myself. Get it properly on the record.
Can you say to us, like, in the answer to the question, did you do it?
We'll be back after this. We're back in Oklahoma.
In the answer to the question, did you do it? Just the kind of the comprehensive.
No.
No?
No, I had nothing to do with that stupid shit.
I wasn't really expecting a confession, obviously, though I had to ask. What I do want to do, though, is have him walk through the details of the police and FBI interviews so we can see if there are any inconsistencies. We have an advantage on him, which is that he doesn't know that we've got the documents. So he doesn't know that we're able to check the details.
What, like, questions were they asking?
If I had any involvement, or did I know who did it, or, you know, well, what'd you do when you were up there? I'm like, I've never been up there.
The FBI that we know about never presented any evidence that placed Cal even remotely in the area of Midwest Firfest when the gas was set off.
I told them to us, check the hotel records. I said, check cameras, because they hold footage for up to 15 years. Major security firms do, major hotels do. Look and see.
We don't have a transcript of the interview itself, just the report. So we don't know what exactly was said word for word. We're only hearing Cal's description of the conversation, and we know he's not the most reliable narrator. We do know from the documents, though, that they searched his car, with his permission, and found nothing, including anything that would imply a long drive to Chicago and back the previous weekend. He says they never asked him about anything specific.
No, they never asked about anything specific, other than, you know, if I was there. And I'm like, well, you were there, weren't you? I'm like, I was taking care of my dad after he'd had a car wreck. He was in a wheelchair and had a colostomy bag. I was changing a poo bag when this happened in Oklahoma.
That's got to have pissed you off, right?
Oh, it pissed me off. And I had one of them, the Rosemont asshole, kind of half-assed threatening me. And he kept at it. And I said, you do realize that Oklahoma's a castle law state, and I do have the right to defend my home, my family, and I am armed. I would quit threatening me. He did.
Yeah, I bet.
Really, I think to myself, you said this to the FBI?
Well, 500 Smith & Wesson makes big holes in things. That's a half-inch diameter slug. I don't play around with that garbage. Threatening is not going to work.
Slight swaggering aside, though, so far, at least on the surface, what Cal is telling us largely lines up with what he told investigators almost a decade ago. Small, unimportant details, like that he prefers outdoor to indoor conventions, match exactly with what he said back then.
Well, what was your involvement in it? I didn't have any involvement in it. Well, why were you there? I wasn't there. And this was the questioning. The same two questions over and over and over. This is a tactic that is well known for making people break. Doesn't work on me. Not going to break to something I didn't do. Usually it pisses me off. I get asked the same stupid question, hoping to get a different answer. Eventually it pisses me off really, really bad.
I take the hint and pivot for now to the question of how his name might have gotten onto the investigators' radar in the first place.
I have no idea. My best guess is same bunch of morons, probably. It's like easy. My guess is they saw an easy opportunity to try to screw me in whatever the hardest way they could.
Cal has a theory, one that goes back to when he served as a moderator on a furry message board called Furry for Life. Moderators on a message board are usually volunteers. They're the people whose job it is to enforce the site's rules and rein in posters' excesses, to take down illegal or barred content, and suspend or ban repeat offenders.
And I followed the rules, the terms of service, and the rules to a T. And I didn't let garbage get through. And people would try to, they'd start talking about drug stuff. They'd start talking about sex related. The chat's 13 and up. No, guys, we ain't playing this game. And I would hammer them for it.
Being a moderator is often a thankless task. And there are people from Furry for Life, he says, who hate him because of things he did while enforcing the rules. People he tangled with or banned, looking for a way to get back at him. That's who he means by the same bunch of morons.
Group that did not like me decided, hey, here's an opportunity to just screw his life.
For what it's worth, in my experience, this scans as at least plausible. Message board mods can sometimes make the kind of enemies who might just call the FBI and tip them your name on something. I've seen stuff like that happen before. But the FOIA docs also mention that Cal's father worked at a chemical plant and took him along with him to work sometimes. That he's familiar with various gas weapons, including Zyklon B and chlorine, and that he'd learned about them from World War reenactments, where he often plays the role of a German officer.
I forgot to ask about the crossover between furries and World War like reenactment stuff.
Oh, good grief. Well, which part of that do you want to delve into? Because you got the reenactor group, you got the different subgroups, you got the Nazi furs. Which one of those turds do you want to step on?
Well, let's step on Nazi furs.
That's a mixed bag. Again, seems like everything in the Phantom is a mixed bag. You have some that are genuine. They believe, you know, oh, that was the greatest party ever. You know, Bob, those are the ones that I look at and go, you're an idiot. And then you have the ones like me that fall into that group because we actually take our time to learn and dig through the history and dig out every bit of the history that went on. Even the obscure stuff, because it all paints a broader picture of how one group of sociopathic shitheads could control a populace. I mean, well, look at Biden. They do the same thing.
Cal wears his politics on his sleeve, and they're politics of the right. Let's not beat about the bush on that. But we're here running down the list of things that may have pointed the authorities so strongly to him as possible domestic terrorist, and his politics could have been one of them, and maybe his politics could have been part of that. Those World War reenactments, the gas knowledge, pictures we've seen of him with Iron Cross medals and the Confederate flag. But so far, at least on the surface, Cal has an answer for most of the questions. And they didn't seem to be landing for the FBI either, which makes sense given the second interview in 2019 marks the end, as far as we can tell, of the police interest in him. Maybe, rather than some neo-Nazi agitator, he is genuinely just a huge history geek. One time in particular, he helped run a big online chat-based multiplayer roleplay set on the battlefields of World War I.
And my job was to keep things historically accurate and make sure to correct them, you know, because I'm reading through the history books while we're doing this. I'm sitting with a physical book. And it was attack on Verdun, the first gas usage. And it came out because it was the gas attack. And they had said, oh, well, the German side released the mustard agent. And I correct, no, it was chlorine. Correct yourself. And it kept having to correct them because nobody actually was reading the history book.
Well, what is the history?
The Second Battle of Verdun was the first use of chemical weapons by the German army in World War I. It was chlorine. And literally what they did is they had these guys run out with big cylinders, stick them in the dirt, make sure the wind's blowing toward the enemy, open the valve. Problem was it only blew that for a little bit and the wind changed direction and they had to run because it blew it back to them.
Your interest in history. Do you think that's one of the reasons the FBI was interested in you?
Yeah, I think that might be part of it because I'd correct them and be like, no, it wasn't this agent, it was this agent. It wasn't, you know, like mustard or they'd say.
He thinks that left a digital footprint.
So you think the feds went control F, chlorine?
Yeah.
And that came up?
Yeah, they're looking through the chat logs and, oh, well, you know, this, chlorine, oh, well, he's accurate on this and this and this. And it's like,
So Cal reckons he was hoist by the petard of his own historical knowledge.
I understand the suspicion. I get it. It looks like the perfect match. It's like, oh, we've got our man, it's perfect, but...
I've been concentrating on trying to keep the good ship interview in relevant waters, while clinging to the rigging for dear life. Which is why, in this moment, I don't actually spot the significance of what he says next, when he's explaining his theory for what happened at MFF that night in 2014.
Yeah. The guy from Rosemount PD, he asked me, he said, well, have you heard anything about it? I said, all I heard is somebody did something stupid and released chlorine gas in a stairwell. And they said, well, how do you think it was done? I said, my guess, and this is just my guess, probably a pickle jar and pool shock it, and some idiot went, hoo-hoo, I'm going to fuck with furries, and broke it in a stairwell. Turns out I was exactly right. Because unfortunately, I know how stupid people are, and it's like, I put two and two together.
When Cal says something, as you've probably gathered so far, it's usually with absolute certainty. Again, it's not lying. Maybe blagging is a better word.
It was pool shock it and water. So, enough, basically, it was like an overchlorinated swimming pool. I'm sure you've walked into an overchlorinated hotel indoor pool and gag and tear up. Apparently, I'd hit it nail on the head and didn't even know it, just by guess, and that was another one that I guess...
Pool shock is a calcified chlorine powder used for cleaning swimming pools. Cal says his family had pools growing up, so he knows how the stuff is used.
When you add liquid bleach to hot water, what's the first thing that happens? Your nose burns and so do your eyes. Because it's releasing chlorine into the air. I mean, people have been around swimming pools or done any heavy-duty cleaning. This is common-sense shit. And I'm one of them people, my brain just automatically puts shit together. Simple as that.
By this point, we've gone over every detail of his story bit by bit. But towards the end, Max takes one more swing.
You're not going to like it, but we got to ask one last time. Did you set off the chlorine gas bomb?
No, wasn't even there. Unfortunately, I guessed as to the modus operandi of what happened. That's the unfortunate part, which apparently made me a prime target. Because apparently common sense automatically makes you a terrorist.
Then it's time for us to go. It's pretty late now. It's pitch dark in the woods around. And it's freezing.
Thanks for putting up with us.
Yeah.
Well, if you guys find your way back down this way in the summertime,
we'll ring you.
Yeah.
I'll get a hold of a big side of beef from my family there.
Oh, hell yeah.
That sounds amazing. That sounds great. Let's play.
Might do some tuna too. Tuna steaks.
Thanks for putting up with that last question. I know you already answered, but
no, you guys are all right. I completely understand. Like I said. When it comes to investigative journalism, or I guess journalism, period, I'm the gold mine because I've gotten dealt with all the dumb shit.
Yeah.
And I'm still here to talk about it.
Well, we appreciate you talking about it.
Yeah, I really do. Sweetest little cat you got there.
Very cute.
I ask if there's anything else he wants to share.
I'll share that. Was that on camera?
Is that a prize winner?
As we pile into the car, all the gears in my head are spinning. Could Cal be the one who did this? Attacked MFF? He thinks the FBI were only interested in him because some trolls set him up. Then, once they started looking, they found his World War stuff. Then, his theory goes, he sealed it by correctly guessing what had gone down. But you heard the guy. How much of what he says can we actually believe? Going round in my mind is something I'd talked about with Pat Chauffeur before this trip, which is, don't confuse likability for proof of innocence. But there's the thing I didn't spot. Apart from me and Max, we have two more people with us, Nick and Ryan. They've been filming, which means they can pay close attention to what Cal's been actually saying. And once we leave Caleb's place, it's Nick who makes the key observation.
He didn't do it because he doesn't know that chlorine needs to be a reactive agent.
He got the mind
that if he knew how it would work, he would be like, he everyone knows that. That you have to have an agent that would do it.
Mm-hmm. He's a champion bullshitter, but he really respects facts. Like, he was asked to be the moderator to correct people because he's a fact corrector.
Yeah.
There's no way he would knowingly brag about knowing the correct formula.
Yeah, I agree.
And lie about it. Unless he's an incredible liar for me. Okay.
Yeah, which he's not.
He's a champion bullshitter. He's not a great liar. I've seen him lie, and I watch his face go down. Like, I see all the lies.
Cal boasted about working out how the attack went down. Except, we've seen the docs. We know he's got the technical details wrong. In order to turn powdered chlorine into that much gas, you need an acid. Strong stuff, hydrochloric or muriatic, as a reacting agent. And though the on-site testing was botched, we know from the first responder report that there was evidence of that kind of liquid dripping in the stairwell. But Caleb confidently told us that the device had been pool cleaner mixed with water. He didn't know about the activating acid. The fiddle he's playing is marked Caleb's right again, but he's got the wrong tune. This is information we can use. Conceivably, maybe this is all an elaborate and elegant misdirect, but it would take serious skill.
And the kind of tall tales that he's been telling are like boasty exaggeration. They're not like covering a sneaky, horrible thing. You know what I mean?
Gut check? For this to be a double bluff, even if we did just witness an extraordinary performance by a world-class liar at the top of their game, someone who's constructed an entire persona to mislead both the FBI and us, a persona that holds together over 10 years, it would also have come down to luck anyway. He doesn't even know there were documents to see, let alone that we have them to check him against. He doesn't know that we know how the attack went down, and he doesn't. He doesn't know what he doesn't know, if you see what I mean.
And part of, I think, what is influencing that is he's just so much talk. Like every single tale he spins is just that.
Yeah.
And I think it would take someone who's, you know, who's not all talk to do this.
Totally.
This isn't proof, but it forms part of a picture. First, again, many of the raw factual details of his story, such as they are, line up with what he told authorities in 2014 and 2019. That he was home looking after his father that weekend and went to see his nephew on the Saturday. He's never wavered on the fact that he's never been to Midwest Fur Fest. And he practically begged the cops to take a polygraph test. We still need to work on testing Caleb's story. And we really need to find out why the FBI came back in 2019. But we're now going to turn our focus another way for a bit. Because, unbelievably, our run of luck continues. Literally while we're in Oklahoma, we got a text we weren't expecting to get. And it's from Robert Sichkowski. Fur and Loathing is a production of Brazen. You can follow the show on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts to stay up to date on new episodes. And follow more of Brazen's award-winning work at brazen.fm. And don't forget to leave us a review. It really does help. Fur and Loathing was produced by Goat Rodeo. The show was written and reported by me, Nikki Wolf, with Max Johnston, Ian Enright, Lucy Woods, and Arnav Binaikia. From Goat Rodeo, lead producer is Ian Enright. Reporting, production, and story editing from Max Johnston. Additional field reporting from Cara Schillen. Voice acting by Hannah Morish, Sam Wolf, and Katie Sherrard. From Project Brazen, senior producer is Nicholas Brennan. Executive producers are Bradley Hope and Tom Wright. Managing producer is Lucy Woods. Associate producing by Arnav Binaikia. Mariangel Gonzalez is our project manager, and Megan Dean is programming manager. Original score by the fabulous Breakmaster Cylinder. Additional music from Ian Enright, Max Johnston, and Blue Dot Sessions. Additional editorial and production assistance at Goat Rodeo from Cara Schellen, Rebecca Seidel, Isabel Kirby-McGowan, Jay Venables, and Megan Nadolski. Additional editorial and production at Project Brazen from Andrea Klarich, Clara Preve, Maddie Forster, and Charlie Barlow. Ryan Ho is series creative director. Cover art by Julian Pradier. Series cinematography by Emmett Brennan and Ryan DeFranco. Special thanks to David Waters. This show couldn't have happened without the involvement and support of the furry fandom. Special thanks to those who shared their stories with us, including Pacho Fur, Atmos Deer, Toa Cat, Ziegler Jaguar, Uncle Kage, and Shy Matsy.